Hello, everyone. My guest today is Brian Halligan. He's the co-founder and CEO of HubSpot, and he's co-authored two books, Inbound Marketing, Get Found Using Google, Social Media, and Blogs, along with Marketing Lessons from the Grateful Dead. Recently, he's been writing about how to turn your startup into a scale-up. Top 10 highest-rated CEO by Glassdoor in 2014, 2015, and 2017. He was named an Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year in 2011 by Inc., Founders 40 in 2016. And Brian is now a senior lecturer at MIT Sloan School of Management. His favorite charity is Camp Harbor View. Brian, are you ready to take us to the top?
Yes.
And we have a guest today, Romeo. Pan your camera down real quick. Let's talk to your dog.
How are we doing, Rome?
Romeo's excited. All right, Brian, HubSpot. Let's talk everything HubSpot. So I'm going to just jump right in because I think, and we'll talk about kind of what you do as you go along. You recently put out a tweet written by, I think, a really great writer, Michael Simmons, about how Zuckerberg and Bezos are optimizing not for 10,000 hours on anything, as Malcolm Gladwell would advocate, but for 10,000 experiments. My question for you is, at HubSpot, you have many different things you do, science fairs, things like that, which we'll talk about. But how do you maximize the number of experiments you're doing at any given time and have a decision process in place to quickly pick a winner to implement it?
Okay. I'm going to tell you the truth about that. The reason I tweeted that is I don't think we're nearly good at it, and we're not at Amazon level or Facebook level. So I sent that around to all our executives, and I tweeted it out to try to motivate the team, like, let's get better at this. Like, there's a reason Amazon and Facebook are doing so well, is they're great at experimenting. And the truth is, when we were very small, you know, 10 employees, 20 employees, it was easy to experiment. It gets harder, which is counterintuitive, as you get bigger, because you have more people and you have more things. There's more value to experimentation. But man, making those changes gets hard. So I think I would give us a D on experimentation, and I want to get to an A plus. So I tweeted that because it's kind of aspirational for me.
What kinds of, I mean, when you say experiments, people could be thinking, well, is he talking about landing page experiments or whole new business model experiments or pricing experiments? Where do you even aim your experimental fire hose at?
Everywhere is the real answer. Of course, landing page and all those growth hacking methods, but sort of we have a direct channel and we have an agency channel. How do we experiment with the shape of the organization and the commission plans and the structures to try to get much better alignment between our customers and our agency partners and our direct sales reps and our agency reps? And a lot of the problem as you get bigger is you do these annual planning cycles, and once a year you make big decisions and you may change your go-to-market or change your setup, and it's just too slow. So what we try to do is break up little teams and let them innovate. Often we do this in Australia, actually, because they speak English and it's sort of an isolated place to experiment. And we try to learn things from them, and if they work, then we apply them to the whole company. But really, we want to experiment everywhere.
Can you tell me the last thing that came out of Australia where it was an experiment and it took off and you said, let's put it across the company?
Yes, it was the way they're using our own products, our chat products on the website, our chat products used on our free users. So we give our free users free chat and support, basically. And a bunch of experiments around our partner channel and how we align our partner channel and our direct organization to maximize the benefits for everybody. So there were three or four over there that worked out really well.
I'm going to very quickly go back because you said this on your Q3 or Q2 investor call, which I believe was it took you guys, you and Dharmesh, 3 years to hit $1 million in revenue. And now you're doing almost $1 million in subscription revenue a day. What percentage of that, you just mentioned your partner program, how many partners do you have and what percentage of those new subscriptions and new revenue is coming through that channel?
Okay. Roughly 60% of our revenue comes from people buying directly from us, and we train them and they go off and they use HubSpot for marketing and selling. Roughly 40% buy HubSpot through an agency partner, marketing agency, sales coach, or whatever. And that sales coach or that marketing agency really goes in and helps them implement it and helps them run HubSpot and helps them do marketing and selling. So it's like you got two models. You can do it yourself or you can have someone do it for you. And it's about a 40-60 split.
What size were you, and this is really for my listeners that are just launching their own companies and helping them understand when they should think about a partner channel. What size were you guys in terms of revenue and maybe customer base when you started onboarding your first partners?
Okay, this was an experiment that worked. So early in HubSpot, I said we're going to be a direct company, at least for the foreseeable future. Product's not ready for an agency partner program. We're just not ready.
This was 2006, by the way.
Yeah, 2006, 2007. At the time, we had lots of leads. We're good at generating leads. We use our own product. We drink our own champagne there. We always have generated way more leads than we could handle, basically. And there were lots of leads coming in from agency partners. And I didn't want to call on them. I was like, we're just not ready. And I had this one early sales guy's name is Pete Caputa. And he said, you know what? We ought to really call on those leads. And I was like, don't touch them. And like once a month, he would come to me. He's like, dude, you're all wet here. We ought to call on these leads. And I said, all right. Why don't you run an experiment and on your nights and weekends, call on those leads and see if you can turn them into something. Within 2 months, he was our number one sales rep.
Oh my God. Did you let him have full creative control? He could decide what the kickback was and everything?
Well, we worked on some of that together, the commission rates and all that stuff. But he basically ran an experiment to try to figure out how to sell HubSpot through agency partner programs. He ran it for 2-3 months and we were like, well, this works and let's formalize it. And, you know, 10 years later, it's 40% of our business. So he did a fabulous job. But that was one of our early experiments that just worked. This is one of the reasons I like experiments so much.
And how many people now are our partners?
I think we have like 3,500 or so.
Our partners, yeah. Amazing. Let's go back now from a product perspective. So you really started obviously as a kind of a single mouse trap, and then that grew and it got a little more complex. And now you have really three different current platforms with a fourth on the way in the form of a customer hub next year. Break down those platforms for us in terms of when they launched and maybe why you launched. Let's just talk about the free CRM aspect.
Okay. When I think about HubSpot inside my head, I think of it as kind of in these chapters. In the first 8 years of HubSpot was chapter one, we were an apps company. We built a marketing app. It was a really good app and marketing departments would buy it and enjoy it. Around 3 years ago, we said, you know, we ought to get into the sales business. The way people are buying is changing a lot. We need to help them figure out how to sell better and build a modern platform to enable modern selling. And so we started with a Skunk Works little startup inside of HubSpot that I was part of and built our CRM product and our sales product. And we zigged and zagged. And my God, that second line of business is going insanely well. And so I describe the process we're going through now as moving from an apps company to more of a suite company. This year, first half of this year, we'll come out with a customer service product. So we'll have a marketing product, a sales product, and a service product. So we're a company in transition. That transition is non-trivial. It's a really tricky transition to go from a one-product company to a multi-product company. And we struggled for a while. And this is the year we really kind of unlocked it and it really took off.
On the most recent investor call, one of the investors, you know, came on, your moderator said, okay, what's your question? And he goes, hey, you know, Brian, John, who's your CFO, Kinzer, hey, I saw your ARPU is down to $10,333 per customer. That's down 4% year over year. ARPU is obviously something people look at. You then countered and tried to explain, well, this sales platform starts at $50 a month. So with higher volume there, that's a much lower price point. But I don't know if they got it. How do you convince Wall Street and these people that sometimes going after volume and letting your customers grow with you is the way to go?
It's very tricky. We made a decision that our marketing product, the average revenue per customer is around $1,000, right?
We're talking monthly, right, Brian?
Yeah, monthly. And our sales cycle was inbound. We would get leads, trial requests, stuff like that. And we use an inside sales force. It was about a 30-day sales cycle. Cost to acquire the customer is maybe $13,000, $14,000. And then when we were going into the sales business, we said, okay, the marketing business is working, but if we were to start that marketing business over, what can we do to really lower that cost to acquire a customer, match the way we sell really with the way people buy, and see if we can scale it in a different way? So instead of using that 30-day inside sales model, inbound model, we call that our content funnel. We use content to drive leads in. We said, let's build a code funnel is what we called it. And it was basically a classic freemium model where we gave the CRM software away for free and then users would buy it for $50 per month. And so our cost to acquire a customer went from, you know, whatever, $13,000 to something like $1,000. So it dramatically dropped, but the total lifetime value is there as well. And so what we look at internally is our old cost to acquire a customer was, let's say, 13, 14,000. Total lifetime value was maybe 55, 60,000. On the sales product, the cost to acquire was more like, you know, $1,000 and then $5,000 total lifetime value. What happened is we blend them together and our total cost to acquire is down or total lifetime value is down, But the ratio is up, and that's what we want. We want the return on CAC to be higher. And we're just pouring new customers in at this lower price point, and then we're able to upsell them the marketing product. So this has really worked out quite well for us.
I'd like to dive into that next, because my first ever kind of engagement with you and really learning from you was when a mutual friend, Joe Barnhauer, introduced us and got me some time with you in your office. And we were chatting briefly, and you said something shocking, which I loved. And then you grabbed the marker and you say, Nathan, let me show you how this works. And you started drawing a chart on your board where you basically started drawing axes. And it wasn't just a Cartesian plane. I mean, you had 3, 4, 5 things from a central point. And you said, Nathan, this is number of seats. This is number of contacts. This is number of blah, blah, blah. And these are all things you can use to drive up your ARPU per account. Walk me through how you think about and identify what value unit is most important to drive higher price points on each of these platforms, sales, marketing, CRM, et cetera.
Okay. Couple thoughts on that. One mistake I think entrepreneurs make and investors make is they don't try to maximize the supply and demand curve. They just keep trying to drive those price points up.
Wait, what do you mean by the supply demand curve?
I mean, really map it. So there's some people out there that would spend $1 for HubSpot. And there's some people out there that would spend $10,000 for HubSpot. Everyone just rushes to the 10, right? That's just the knee jerk. How do we maximize ARPU? They end up going up market. And historically, that's been the move, because you couldn't really get at the low end of the market. But the internet kind of allows you to explore that low, fat, large, low end of the supply and demand curve. And so we went counterintuitively, you know, we explored both sides and we went down that supply and demand curve and we came out with our second product. And it really opened up the number of customers we got, and then we could start cross-selling them. And so that's the first comment I would make is, we had a hell of a time convincing venture investors that SMB was a good place to make money. They looked at it and they said, well, Intuit was a good company, but who else? Good point. You know, there hasn't been a lot.
Well, Brian, and they're looking up your beltway at Constant Contact, going, they're adding 60,000 SMBs, but churning 50,000, right? It doesn't work.
Now, the key is you can now build an SMB business, but you have to do two things. One, you need to keep your cost to acquire a customer under control. You can't acquire customers through Google AdWords and TV ads and stuff like that, because the math just blows up. Two, you need your retention rates to be at 100%. So at HubSpot, let's say we lose 17 customers a year. Let's say you start with 100 customers, you lose 17. Your pricing model has got to be set up such that the 83 left pay you $17 more. So your net retention is 100%. If you can do those two things, my God, is there opportunity in SMB. All the competition's up in the enterprise. SMB is where I think the next big giant company's gonna be able. Shopify's killing it. HubSpot's doing pretty well. Xero. There's a bunch of these companies who are starting to figure out the new way to get at that SMB market. I'm super excited about that.
Last question on this part. Because I think this is really important. How do you decide that the sales platform is going to, the pricing is going to be based off number of seats versus the CRM is number of contacts? And I know that sounds trivial, but a lot of entrepreneurs have trouble finding that one value metric that they can actually tie pricing to.
Okay. We spent hundreds of hours on this.
Okay, good. Makes me feel better about the question.
We have spent thousands of hours on our price model HubSpot. And by the way, I don't think we've got it right. We've got it like vaguely right, but it has been a nonstop topic. On the marketing side, the tricky thing for selling to a marketing department, most software companies these days sell per seat, but there's just not a lot of people in a marketing department. You know, we sell to a company with a startup, they got 50 employees and 7 marketers, just not a lot of seats there. And so we're like, well, how do you tie the value we deliver to the amount they pay? And so we come up with this idea of just, it's contacts. The more contacts in your database, the more you pay effectively. And so we have basic pro enterprise, like every damn software company out there. And then the y-axis is how many contacts you have in your database. What I like about pricing models like that is our incentives are aligned. The better our customers do, the more they pay us.
Yep.
And so that's our marketing product. And then we come up with a sales product. And we're like, all right, you can't charge on contacts for sales guys because it's so random how many contacts they'll have. And we don't want them spamming people out of the CRM system. So we use seats as a close enough proxy. And so we have a marketing product based on contacts and a sales product based on seats. That is not ideal, by the way, because you have to think about it. And you don't want people to have to think about your pricing model. But it's working well enough at this point that we're sticking with that.
Generally, would you recommend to new entrepreneurs to focus on one of those value drivers? Or generally speaking, the more axes you have per product, the better to upsell people?
I think the simpler, the better. So when we first started HubSpot, it was like the Model T. I don't care what color you want it, as long as it's black. we had a product called HubSpot, not Basic Pro Enterprise. It was $250 a month. And that was it for the first 5 years of HubSpot. And then we got really bold and we came out with HubSpot Basic, Pro, and Enterprise. And that was it for like 3 or 4 years. Then we raised our round from Sequoia. And this guy named Pat Grady at Sequoia, who is an expert on pricing. And he was the one who schooled us on this kind of two-axis pricing. It's like you need a second axis around something like contacts or seats. If you don't create that second axis, you won't get that uplift. When we did our round with Sequoia, our customer retention rate was something like 70%.
Logo or revenue?
What's that?
Logo or revenue?
Logo.
Okay.
Around 70. I don't remember exactly. Our revenue retention rate, including upsell, was maybe 75. Since then, our customer logo retention rate, you know, is in the low 80s. So that's improved. But our revenue retention rate's 100%. And so the upsell went from 5% to 17%. And Sequoia's point was, you need to figure out a way for the customers you're delivering the most value to extract a little bit more value in a way that's not douchey. And that has made all the difference for HubSpot. If our customer retention rate was 70 and our revenue retention rate was 75, I wouldn't be on this call with you today. We'd be part of some other company. It just won't scale. It'll scale when you're small. This is why cost to acquire matters. When you're small, you got 1,000 customers, and your retention rate is 70%. You lose 300 customers. You can replace the 300 and add another 500 relatively easily. If you got 100,000 customers and your retention rate 70%, you lost 30,000 customers. To grow 50%, you got to add 80,000 customers. The cost to acquire is what ends up getting you. So you got to nail both. The cost to acquire has got to scale, and you've got to get a pricing model and a value prop such that you can get 100% revenue retention.
A great points, Brian. On that note, let's wrap up with the famous five. Number one, what's your favorite, besides your own, of course, what's your favorite business book?
Oh my God, that's a great question. My favorite, you know, we read Blue Ocean Strategy when we first started HubSpot, and we've used that over and over.
Brian, you're aging yourself here. Blue Ocean Strategy.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, it's just right on so many levels about so many things. Yeah, I still like that book.
All right, number two, is there a CEO you're following or studying right now?
Like everyone else on the planet, I'm trying to figure out what Bezos is doing so right.
Number three, is besides any of your own, is there a favorite online tool you use to grow HubSpot?
Yeah, Spotify.
Number, it's good energy, right? Number four, how many hours of sleep do you get every night?
I get over 8 a night, and then I take a nap every day.
That's pretty good. And Brian, what's your situation? Married, single, you have kiddos?
I'm single. I have a 13-year-old kiddo.
Single and rom, right?
Yep.
All right. And how old are you?
I'm 50 this year.
50. Congrats. Last question here. Take us back 30 years. What do you wish the 20-year-old Brian Halligan knew?
Dalai Lama's got a really good saying: live a good, honest, healthy, noble life. And then when you're old, you get to enjoy it twice. and that's sort of how I like to live my life. Just try to do things right and do things I'm happy with. The other saying I like these days, my friend John Azaroff says all the time, he's like, do more of what you love, do less of what you tolerate, do none of what you hate. And that's sort of something I wish I had done earlier in my career.
There you guys have it from Brian earlier. He used the analogy. He's drinking his own champagne, not even Kool-Aid. That tells you about the culture at HubSpot. They're chugging champagne. Live life honestly, nobly. Do what you love. They launched back in 2006. They're now doing well over $280 million in revenue. Over 34,000 customers across 90 countries using three different core products. Their sales product, their CRM product, their marketing platform. Look out for their customer hub coming in 2018, which will include many things like live chat, chatbots, things like that. Brian Halligan, thank you for taking us to the top.
Thank you.